Tonight's special presentation of L.A.'s Treasure, Stan Chambers, is brought to you in part by GTE. And by Federal Express. For documents, packages, and freight worldwide, our most important package is yours.
It's 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and one of the reporters for KTLA News arrived for work. An ordinary occurrence, if it were not for the fact that this star reporter, Stan Chambers, has been coming to work at KTLA for the past 45 years. He's worked nowhere else. His story is the story of Southern California since 1947. He's seen it all, reported most of it, and along the way, he's shared it with you, the audience. So tonight, we honor this unprecedented achievement by the Dean of Los Angeles Television Reporters, Stan Chambers, L.A.'s treasure. I'm Hal Fishman, Channel 5 News. On this program, we're going to look back on a remarkable career, which is still in progress, and how our city has changed in the 45 years that Stan Chambers has been covering this town for Channel 5. We've dusted off the old films and tapes, and also did something very unusual. We sat Stan Chambers down for once in his career so that he could reminisce a bit about all he's seen and been a part of since the day he started at KTLA, December the 1st, 1947. And let's hope it's a quiet time here in the city, because if not, this very program might be interrupted by Stan doing a special report from somewhere. We're going to start with some tape shot just a few weeks ago. We wanted to take you behind the scenes to see how Stan spends an average day. So we followed him and his crew with one of our own crews from 3 p.m. to 11 p.m. A typical day in the life of Stan Chambers.
So I'll be going to be out in the mobile unit, yeah, listening to the scanner. Resolve. I just heard one of those incomplete transmissions, but it's Panorama City, a shooting, and perhaps near a school. I think I don't know if anyone was injured or what, but I just heard that.
Hello.
Hi. Good. Did you see what happened at all?
We heard what happened.
Basically, what did you hear?
A fellow in the blue car was coming through the intersection.
Uh-huh.
Apparently, someone jumped out of the car and shot him.
What can you tell us at this point?
Well, right now, we don't have much to go on.
Hi.
It's a long time.
Oh. Well, thank you. Shooting took place just across the street from Sepulveda Junior High School. The victim was taken to Holy Cross Hospital for further treatment. From Sepulveda, Stan Chambers, Channel 5 News at 10. What's your name? Huh?
Arthur, can I shake your hand?
Oh, there. Thank you, Arthur.
Hi, we're just leaving now. Should we head back your way? Track for the intersection shooting. 5, 4, 3. Late this afternoon, a gunman in a car fired several shots into this blue Monte Carlo. Both vehicles were moving in the intersection.
No, track's ready and we're all set to go.
Okay. Do you want to go ahead and just break for lunch and, we'll keep our ears open?
Okay.
Must have picked up a nail. It's still hissing, Eric.
Yeah, please. We hit the curb there.
Well, all we got to do is call the AAA and they'll come get us out of here. Part of news, you know.
Valley and Eastern. And there is a fatality. No.
How are you, sir?
Fine, Sarge. Stan Chambers. Just fine.
Good
nice
to see you.
Well, feeling good. Oh dear. Was it just lost control or was that?
No, it appears as though
He was coming around this corner. He's under the influence and drifted, and it just smacked the rear of the truck. And the driver was okay. He's intoxicated, but he's okay. And the passenger, of course, not wearing a seatbelt, went straight forward and hit the either the beat pillar on the truck or the back.
We have shots that we can use. Didn't they put the blanket up over the body?
Yeah, we do.
Yeah, okay.
I didn't shoot any shots without the blanket.
Okay.
It was such a mess.
Track for the El Sereno fatal. 5, 4, 3. Officers are waiting for the coroner this evening. One man is dead at the scene. Didn't know you had the duty tonight.
Yeah, I have the duty tonight.
Good.
So, yeah. Well, they made their first arrest for
they did.
DUI.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And they go into the school parking lot.
They go in this parking lot here.
Oh, great.
So, had about a case of beer with them. So that's the first arrest today.
Yeah, AJ 10, I'm ready to set up your signal to Mount Wilson for Stan's live shot.
Right you are, Jim. Thank you. I can. Loud and clear, Kim. Thank you. And you say about 14 for us, right? 10, 14. Fine. Thank you.
Los Angeles County Sheriff's Department has set up a sobriety checkpoint in San Francisco.
We're right on Rosecrans, right near Paramount High School. All the cars that are going eastbound on Rosecrans have been funneled down to a single lane. And as they come by here, the deputies either wave them through or stop them. The checkpoint, they take an observation as to if a driver might be drinking, if he might be under the influence, if there are any symptoms. If so, they are held, brought off to the side. And then those that are going on through, they're asked to help the community. This sobriety checkpoint will continue for some time. We'll be standing by, but right now, back to Hal. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thanks a million.
Yeah, very good, Sam.
Sure, appreciate it.
No problem.
Good.
No problem.
Really do.
Good.
So hope we get some good results.
Oh, yeah.
And that was a slow day for Stan. It was a very different Los Angeles back on December 1st, 1947, the day that Stan Chambers started work at KTLA.
The mayor at the time, Fletcher Bowron, announced there would soon be a marked improvement in the smog situation. The population of Van Nuys went from 26,000 in 1940 to 72,000 in 1947. Subdivision became the magic word, mass production by methods developed during World War II. 12,000 veterans were arriving in Los Angeles every month. The head of the L.A. Veterans Service Center suggested, "We should put up a sign in every major railroad center reading, 'Veterans, don't come to Los Angeles. We can't give you a job, an education, or a roof over your head.'" There were about 3,000 television sets operating in Los Angeles. Stan Chambers was born in L.A., went to Loyola High School, USC, and then into the U.S. Navy during World War II.
When I got out of the Navy, I went back to USC on the GI Bill. What a great place it was to be, because everybody was getting out of the service. They were coming back here, doing what they wanted to do. All of those restraints from the service were over, and it was a whole new life for everyone. One of the things I did right away was to get into radio and get into magazine publishing. I was at KUSC and working there doing sportscasts and newscasts and really enjoying it. And then one of my real loves was a program called Campus Magazine. In fact, this is the office right here. This little office, the other side was Silverwoods, but this was perfect. It was right on the row. Everybody came on by and we were quite a social center. Well, at one time, I was an editor on Campus Magazine, and I was also working on that radio station. And I heard a program one night saying that one of the local television stations had expanded its broadcasting schedule. I didn't even know that television was on the air. And I thought, you know, that might be a good idea. why don't we take an issue of Campus Magazine? We'll show the cover girl. We'll show some of the humorous articles, rewrite them for television. Show the UCLA basketball star who was always out ahead of everyone else. Put it together and do a broadcast. Well, I called up Gordon Wright at KTLA. I remember going to the payphone at Sunset and Vine Street, right across from NBC. And Gordon Wright picked up the phone. I said, how about doing a program on a campus magazine? So that sounds interesting. I'm too busy right now, but call me next week. This was T-Day, the first big promotion for television. And that was the day I called Gordon. Next week, we went over, went to Oblatt's for a bran muffin, a cup of coffee, and I explained the situation. He said, great, let's do it. So about 25 of the students here at school took our campus magazine. We all did different things. Went over to KTLA and put on Campus Magazine of the Air, the television version, because we started the radio version on KLAC just a couple weeks before. That was my debut. And after it was over, I thought, oh, this is a wonderful job. And then I went back here for a long period of time, about 6 months, and I got a call from Gordon Wright. They were expanding the broadcast schedule. Would I be interested in going to work for KTLA? That was December 1st, 1947.
In those days, KTLA was located just across the street from the Paramount Studio Gate in Hollywood, which was not so unusual since Paramount owned the fledgling station in those days. Recently, we took Stan back to that first studio, which served later as the home of KMEX Channel 34.
Well, you can imagine going into the industry and working right outside the Paramount Gate, that famous gate that's known all around the world. And then to actually go into the studio, this great old garage, and a garage is what it was, and anybody could walk in, the door would swing open, and when you got inside there, there would be a lot of empty chairs around for the studio audiences and everything. Another thing I really loved, this was a very, well, it's a regular city street, but we had commercials, and we didn't have any place inside to do them. So we used to bring out red carpets, a couple of potted plants, and bring in the cars and sell them right here in the street. The people were very kind, and they'd wait for us till we finished the commercials. We did that for a long time. Then we'd get very fancy, put up a different set, and one night the wind knocked all the sets over, and a couple hit the cars, but we went on anyway. Now, another place that was very effective, a good alley here. Nothing like an alley when you have to do some real work. So what we did, we'd line up a lot of the used cars, and they could go right on down here. So they'd run up right here, would give certain details on that car, it'd move on down, and the next one came up. So this was a great place, a lot of memories, quite a building. Well, it really looks pretty much the same. It's painted now. KMEX, entrance. Oh, they have doors here now. This used to be the ramp going up into the garage, and we bring all of the props over from the Paramount Studios and right up the ramp into the set. Let's see what's in here. Oh, boy, have things changed. Look at this. Oh, this is really different. Stucco walls and the tile in the floor and the railing here. Oh, I remember this. This was the only bathroom at the station. There wasn't such a thing as a men's room or a women's room. And it really was quite serviceable, except one night we were doing Magazine of the Week, and on the animal page we had a frisky monkey, and they just couldn't keep it under control, so we put it in the bathroom. Worked out okay, except for the people who didn't know it was there. And news would be roughly about here, and it was much smaller. One thing, this is the exterior wall, and we didn't have any door to get out on this side of the building, so the building and safety people worried about fire, said we've got to do something about that. Well, if we took a door in there, we wouldn't have an office. So there was a lot of negotiations. What they did, they came up with a decision. We'd have it's like a drawer about 2 feet off the ground, horizontal, and you would open it, and then you'd just roll out in case there was a fire. Nobody ever had to use it, thank goodness. Well, now this door looks pretty much, although, again, we didn't have doors. We just had, like, curtains to go in. Oh, this looks more like it now. Look, the same acoustic tile. And the props are on wheels. We used to do that, too, because you can't hammer into a cement floor, so you had to do that. And look at the overhead. Those are the same beams. That's the way the lights hung. And, oh, was it hot in here. It was absolutely unbearable. You know, air conditioning was really just coming into its own at that time. We did have air at that time. We did have air conditioning, but that was in there for the equipment, not for the human beings. It was for the new equipment. So out here, it was just unbearably hot. And we used to have a bank of lights right here, and we'd move it right up right next to the camera, and there would probably be 20 lights on that, and we'd have 20 on behind. And boy, is this impressive to see the new set, because our set would have been a good-sized desk, a chair, a map, and that was probably it. You know, one of the first commercials that we ever had was Rancho Soup. Gil Martin was the newscaster, and Rancho Soup was the sponsor. Well, you know, in those days, we were very proud to have our commercials, and so we worked out a format to where Gil would give the news, and then halfway through, he would stop, and he'd say, this chicken gumbo is delicious. It's Rancho Soup. And he'd take a couple of spoonfuls and then go back to the news. Can you imagine if Hal Fishman did that today? We just couldn't do that. Here are the props. We have plenty of props over here. And I got pretty good at moving couches. Oh, no, they're still heavy. But, you know, we had a small staff, and we had all of the executives who worked during the day until about 5 o'clock. And then they became stage crew. They took their coats off, and they came out, and they pushed the camera dollies, and they worked the mic booms, and they actually helped put on the show. So that was really something that I decided I'd rather be on the stage crew side, because I started out helping building sets. I had to help. I didn't know really how to do it. Moving props in, dressing the sets, moving the light booms in. I was pretty good with the booms and with the camera dollies. The cameras are so big, we actually had to have someone with a camera dolly to push it in there. And back in here, it would be all of the engineering equipment. That was something. And I noticed they have a door. It's probably not the same door, but we used to bring our cameras through here. For example, a show is going on at this point. The show finishes. 2 minutes of commercials go on the air. Everybody goes racing out here. Opens up the door. Can we come in? And the other commercial, or the other set, goes on over here. So now they have cameras in both sides. But when these cameras went through the door with 10 or 15 crew members, it was really quite a traffic jam. And of course, one of the shows I did do was Tricks and Treats with Chorus Guy. And we did the cooking show every day, and it was a wonderful, wonderful experience.
Tuesday night, and time for KTLA's home economist, Chorus Guy in Tricks and Treats.
Hello, everyone. It's good to be with you again tonight. Sam, what are you doing?
Come here, look at Joe.
What's he doing?
Looks like he's farming or something. He's got look at that, about a 3x4 plot or something. Isn't that amazing?
Bigger than that, really, yeah.
Poor old Joe.
Oh, the rest of you too.
Hi, Joe.
Hi, Joe.
Imagine that's about a 3x4 plot of ground or something, and he has some
looks very ambitious.
Hope he keeps busy. What have we got here, Chorus?
Well, you know, Stan, I don't usually do any comparative testing of food.
I know you don't.
Well, tonight I'd like to have you try, though, two different cups of coffee.
Well, that's fair enough. Is this something new, though? Mm-hmm.
This is marked A for your benefit.
A.
Uh-huh.
What do you want? Oh, I know. Now, let's see. You want me to tell which of the MJB?
Uh-huh, that's right.
Well?
I want to see if you can tell.
Mmm, that's good. When I went to work, my voice was very high, very unusual, and Klaus Landsberg said that he really didn't want me doing any off-camera announcing. Wait a while, so I never got to do that. But I got to do some live programs. In fact, my first program was right here in the studio. It was members of the Australian polo team who were visiting Los Angeles, and we talked polo for 10 minutes. But the thing that that happened is that with the old cameras where you didn't have the detail, my lips kind of, they looked, as they called them, Betty Boop lips. And that is hardly the way you start a television career. So they didn't want me to be on the air because of my lips, and I couldn't be off the air with my voice because of my voice. It was kind of a slow start. Then when the new generation of cameras came in,
the lips began to look more in their natural form. I was very thankful for that latest invention.
The man who ran KTLA and put it on the air, and who hired Stan Chambers, was the late Klaus Landsberg, a German immigrant who had started to create an experimental television station for Paramount during the war. Klaus Landsberg's wife at that time was Evelyn DeWolf.
Everything was beginning to look like there were going to be networks and there were going to be so many things, and a little bit of the competition was sneaking in. And that was the year, actually, that Stan joined KTLA. And I remember that this was a very handsome man. That was the first impression I had. And the second impression, I found him running around the studio, you know, pushing little sets and doing odds and ends and working in the back room. And one day I said to Klaus, "What's that good-looking guy doing in the back room all the time? He should be in front of the cameras." And Klaus, you know, pretty much decided what he wanted to do in his own time. I would say that I helped to speed the process.
Klaus Landsberg used to love to take his live cameras out of the studio to show all parts of Southern California to the greatly increasing number of viewers that were now watching Channel 5. These days, with satellites and miniature equipment, it's very easy to get a television signal from virtually any location. But back in the late 1940s, it was a major undertaking. For example, a program from right here at the corner of Hollywood and Vine meant taking the microwave dish to the top of one of these buildings and aiming it at Mount Wilson with heavy cables hanging over the roof to the remote trucks below. One of Stan's first regular host jobs came from this very spot.
Bill Welch and I were some of the announcers on that program. People would just go up to the corner, and we would talk to everybody and talk as long as we could about whatever were the big issues of the day. And it was interesting because people would go up there to be on television. In those years, it was quite a thing to be on television. You'd be the local celebrity when your friends and neighbors say, "Hey, I saw you in Meet Me in Hollywood." And it's interesting, just recently, I got a letter from a lady who said she used to go up to Hollywood and Vine to be on the air, went up several times, but never made it. She didn't get her few moments of glory.
There are no recordings of Meet Me in Hollywood to be found, but back in 1981, Channel 2's Two on the Town with Steve Edwards took Stan and his Meet Me in Hollywood co-host Bill Welch to the corner of Hollywood and Vine one Friday evening to recreate Meet Me in Hollywood.
Good evening, everyone.
This is Hollywood and Vine. There go the two ladies I wanted to talk to crossing the street.
Hi.
What's your name?
Beth Button.
And Beth, do you sell roses?
Yeah.
How's business?
Very good.
Where do you get the roses?
From my supplier.
Tell us about them now. What kind are they? Can we see them? Let's pick them up and let's take a look.
I think they're about 22 inches.
Uh-huh.
That they have red and pink.
And how is the rose business?
It's blooming.
It really wouldn't bind.
Where else? I know this is something by Beethoven, but can we interrupt it?
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
What do people say about your music?
I get a lot of positive response. I've been doing it for since my last lifetime, so. I've been doing it for about 3.5 years, started down in New Orleans, so I've been getting a lot of positive here and a lot of places in the nation.
What do you say to people that say there are a lot of characters in Hollywood Boulevard?
Well, there are. I agree. But there's a lot of good energy down here. It's really nice.
Okay, something by Bach, maybe?
Something by Bach?
Yeah, let's...
How about a little bit of Chinese bluegrass, Russian punk, and country reggae?
Sounds great.
Whatever it is, I'm for it. There we go.
Now tell us, you have a single rose there. Where did you have a single rose?
Well, there's a lady walking down the street selling them.
Welcome to Hollywood and Vine.
Thank you very much.
Tell me, Steve, where do you live?
I was right down the street and around the corner and into the valley.
I see.
We have been standing here watching. First of all, the crowd is getting bigger and bigger here at Hollywood and Vine.
And this has been interesting. I have the feeling that somebody's going to watch this thing tonight and say, get those two guys, find out if they're under contract. We got a new show to put on the network.
Well, you know, we would still have been here if Klaus Landberg had decided on a new musical show called The Lawrence Welk Show. That's what preempted it.
Right, you guys lost out to Welk?
As you can tell, for the first couple of years of television in Southern California, most of the programs were light and fluffy. There was very little news on the air, and sports programming took up quite a bit of time. But on April the 9th, 1949, television grew up. Stan Chambers was here at what is now San Marino High School when the turning point came for a medium that had been primarily entertainment.
On April 9th, 1949, this was a vacant lot. And right about here was an abandoned water well that reached 230 feet down into the ground. 3.5-year-old Kathy Fiscus lived nearby, and on that fateful day, she went playing in the lot. Somehow, she tumbled into the well. So we started in, and having no idea that we'd be here any length of time. It was, let's see what's going on. The thing that is so incredible looking back now, we had no idea of the impact that this was going to make. I can remember sitting in the front of a pickup truck, kind of cold, maybe 2 a.m. with the microphone on my lap and thinking, who in the world would be watching this? It really brought the city together. Los Angeles was a big city, but on this one weekend, it became a small town city. Neighbors would visit neighbors that they didn't know very well. They'd sit in front of the set. They'd have dinner there. They'd go to sleep on the floor. Really right up to the end, well, till an hour or two before the end, we really thought that she was going to be saved. And all of a sudden, the word was that she was dead. And everybody broke into tears. Everybody was quiet. People walked away to be by themselves. And it was a very emotional thing. And I think that's the impact that people watching had, that for the first time, they experienced the long form of television, that they were a part of this whole broadcast from the moment they started looking. And having spent that much time and that much emotion and that much energy to find out that she was dead, the whole city really suffered a personal loss.
With the Kathy Fiscus telecast, we went into it and did it. And it was over before I had any idea of the impact of it. And then to look back and say, gosh, we were on the air for 27 hours. It was a very impressive program that moved people. And then to have the reaction and all of a sudden to feel like, you know, maybe I'm going to be a television broadcaster. It was a very, very big thing.
Our salute to Stan Chambers. 45 years with KTLA continues with Frosty Frolics, the first TV helicopter, Stan's motion picture debut.
I know. Say we didn't get the package.
Martha!
Tom! Did you get our package?
Gee, it never got here.
Really?
Introducing tracking software from Federal Express.
It was delivered to your place at 9:22 a.m.
Oh! Probably stuck in the mailroom.
No, it was signed for by your partner, Brian.
Now you can track packages right from your computer on your desk.
Brian, are you there?
Oh, that package, Martha! We could negotiate a deal.
The Grupa. On a good day, you dive to depths of over 8,000 feet. If you think that's low, you should see GTE's new proposed long-distance rates. They will drop overall by 34%, daytime calls by 42%, and GTE will introduce new residential discount calling plans to reduce long-distance rates even more. Now that's low. To find out more, just give us a call.
Cream cheese, FON first prize with my secret ingredient. Pace picante sauce ain't no secret. I use Pace in my queso dip. Just add Pace to Velveeta cheese spread and microwave.
Shoot, Pace picante sauce will liven up any dip.
I got a secret ingredient.
That stuff made in New York City.
Pick up your party dips. Pick up the Pace.
That's one secret you ought to keep the lid on.
Now, Subway invites you to be our guest at Walt Disney's World on Ice. Come into Subway for a mouth-watering 6-inch meatball sub served hot on our fresh-baked bread with your choice of Subway's free fixins. all for just $169. And pick up a family savings certificate to the fabulous production of Beauty and the Beast. Save $3 on each. Enjoy the show. Enjoy the meal. At $169, it's the beauty of a deal.
Announcing C&R's sale of the decade. Lowest prices of the year. Save coat and slat. The same suits at the Broadway for $300 are half price, only $150 at C&R. Camel hair sport coats, $355 at Nordstrom. Only $180 at C&R. The same wool slacks, $110 at Robinson's May. Half price at C&R. Save up to 60% on every fall suit, sport coat, and slack at C&R's Sale of the Decade. Hurry!
Most car owners praise the quality of their purchases. But only one car line has been ranked best overall in initial quality by J.D. Power and Associates. Lexus. So the question isn't whether you put your car on a pedestal, but how often. And the Lexus LS is thousands less than the leading European competition.
At your Southern California Lexus dealer.
Gravity. It's more than a fragrance. It's a force of nature. Gravity. For men. You couldn't resist it, even if you tried.
It took a lot more than tough cowboys to win the West. Lady Stetson. The spirit of the West. The power of a woman. Lady Stetson. It's how the West was won.
The 1950s in Los Angeles was a time of tremendous growth.
In December of 1950, the last streetcar made its run from downtown Los Angeles to Venice. The Hollywood Freeway is completed in 1952, and by mid-decade, there are more than 350,000 television sets in L.A. And in the early 1950s, KTLA's news coverage is booming. You could expect to see Stan Chambers everywhere. In Wilmington for a refinery explosion in 1951.
At present, the fire is contained. It is not what you'd say under control, but it is contained right now. It is being fought from several different locations. And right now on the... They're calling in some men. They're calling for some help right now. Men are going up there. We don't know exactly what their purpose will be. There is a bulldozer working over there. There is a bulldozer working at this point to further protect the actual area.
And in 1953 at the atomic test site in Nevada for coverage of an above-ground A-bomb test, along with then KTLA News director, the late Gil Martin.
Gil, have you seen many more desolate places than this place where we are today? There's a lot of snow and kind of a flat top there. That's the actual peak, the top 11,000 feet of Mount Charleston.
It is interesting to bring this following information to you. I mentioned it earlier that no chapter could be possibly closed without paying tribute to the achievement here today, which was made possible by scaling some of these mountains and barren peaks which you see here today. 18, 19, 20, 21, and there it is, that brilliant flash, that white light that precedes the explosion of the atomic bomb number 17. 40 miles away, a brilliant white flash, almost blinding with those rocket trails coming out of it.
It's a tremendous thing, Gil, that huge ball of fire on that, almost the horizon there and jumping up in that tremendous mushroom cloud. It really scares you. I have a lot of respect for that bomb, even from 40 miles. As those troops go in, they're able to actually determine how their particular equipment will fare under atomic bomb attack. It was a tremendous thrill to see that tremendous fireball, and I know our viewers at home got a good look at that. The cameras are right on it, so they could see the real fury of the atom bomb.
And while the cameras are in Nevada anyway, why not send Stan and longtime KTLA favorite Dick Lane to cover the El Dorado Parade in Las Vegas? Klaus Landsberg made certain that all his television personalities were versatile. They could do all kinds of television, from news to cooking shows to variety programs. Frosty Frolic started on KTLA in 1951, and for most of its two-year run, originating from the Winter Garden in Pasadena. The building is now a storage facility. Stan Chambers was the host of Frosty Frolics.
It's Frosty Frolics,
your musical comedy on ice.
Wanted, opportunity for young man. Mediocre appearance will do. No salary, but free tourist class accommodations for France. Oh, boy, it's the real chance. Paris, here I come.
I know you've been waiting, oh, 20 minutes or so, but please, pardon. Our chef insists that everything be cooked to the perfect perfection. Pardon me, Uma Moore and I will chef with the chef. Pardon?
It was a musical variety on ice. It was here at the Pasadena Winter Garden and also at the Polar Palace in Los Angeles. And the performers were all really great skaters. They were in ice capades or ice follies. Most of them lived in Los Angeles, and this way they were able to keep their ice skating careers going and work at other jobs. And it was 1 hour, fine music. We had a good German band under Manny Strand. We had built a Alpine hotel, and it was right there on the ice. In fact, we used to get phone calls at the station from people saying, can we make reservations at the Alpine Hotel for the show next week?
Pleasure and honor that we present subjects from your vast empire, from many of the great nations of the world in this command performance. First, from the land of Scotland, some of their native dancers, some of their most expert dancers. Your Majesty, may I present them.
We'd go over to Paramount and bring out the props they happen to have available. Build a Moroccan village 1 week, a Tahitian village the next week, a German forest the week after that. And then one of the skaters on the broadcast was going to get married. And it was, we were all excited about it and everything. And Klaus decided, why don't we televise the wedding?
Incidentally, speaking of last minute, you know, we're having a big wedding up at the hotel today. The whole village is just, well, all excited about it. Shirley Lander is getting married today. I'm not kidding. This is a real marriage. Shirley is being married up at the hotel about Frosty Frolic tonight. All of you are invited to attend the wedding. So I'm going to head off right now and go up to the Hotel Alpine.
Who couldn't skate. So what we would do at the end of the broadcast, I would always somehow get out toward the middle and do something, and I would fall. And then the skaters, the fraulettes, they were, I guess they were either half a dozen or a dozen of the chorus girls, you might say. They would come out and make a big circle and dance around me as I was there on the wet ice. And I think I fell down in every Frosty Frolic show for several years.
KTLA, as you know, is located in Hollywood, and so it was only a matter of time that Stan, handsome and well-spoken, would be asked to play a part in a motion picture. And so it was that in 1957, right over there below the Griffith Observatory, Stan Chambers made his feature film debut.
Ladies and gentlemen, you're witnessing a manhunt for the biggest man in existence.
We're in Griffith Park. It's been surrounded by troops. They're moving up to try to make contact. That building you see up there is the Griffith Observatory. Now the searchlights are swinging over to our left.
Quickly, we have to go.
Look! Look at the giant!
Film was called The Amazing Colossal Beast, in case you may have forgotten it. To this date, it is Stan's only film role, and fortunately for us, he had not given up his KTLA job to make that picture. This is Skycam 5, KTLA's television eye in the sky. News helicopters are pretty commonplace today, but back in 1958, KTLA introduced the first television helicopter to the world. The live inaugural show started in the KTLA parking lot and almost wound up in a disaster as the newly named KTLA telecopter momentarily did not retract its antenna. An integral part of that inaugural show was Stan Chambers.
This is the telecopter station, KTLA Channel 5, Los Angeles.
But there is a beautiful live shot right now. The helicopter is over the Memorial Coliseum. There are the instructions for the helicopter to proceed to land, and it will now circle again and come in this large cement area. A beautiful shot from that picture. The first live telecast from a helicopter, a truly history-making event. Now, we are shooting it from our camera on the ground. It'll circle over the tall trees. We'll come in during that particular area there. It's coming in very slowly now. We'll hit just about this spot in the middle of the cement area. You hear the loud roar of the prop. The kids are there. A big blast of wind hits us there. And the helicopter has made its rendezvous here at the Coliseum.
We are going to have a very novel item on the helicopter very soon. It's a tremendous flashing light on the underside of the ship that will be able to be seen for 30 miles in broad daylight. So we're going to have to eliminate 8 pounds, which we already have figured out.
Uh-huh.
This will allow the public, when they see a flashing light in the sky, to go in there and turn their set on, because they know something is going to be happening.
So this means when you see that flashing light on this helicopter, get to Channel 5 right away for the big story. So here comes our remote unit right now. Excuse me one second, sir. Here's the unit coming up right here. We saw televising live on the freeway. If you remember earlier, our helicopter picked it up. It received the signals, had a little traffic help from our helicopter. This is our prowl car. This is the special that is on the scene to bring you all of the news as it takes place. Well, there she goes, our airborne special helicopter number one. Ladies and gentlemen, your first historic telecast, the first live telecast from a helicopter has been completed. We invite you for all special events to watch KTLA Channel 5. So watch KTLA for helicopter number one.
In 1959, Stan became one of the first local television reporters to broadcast from Russia. Here in Moscow, he shows local residents something they've never seen, a Polaroid camera.
Our program will be back with Stan's coverage of the Bel Air fire, the Watts riots, and more of the turbulent 60s. Tonight on the Channel 5 News at 10, a suspect is arrested in the Polyclass kidnapping. Antoine Miller is formally sentenced, while Damian Williams awaits his. World AIDS Day promotes knowledge, hope, and anger throughout the globe.
You are doing nothing!
An anniversary celebration turns violent. Our own Stan Chambers story continues on the front lines of the Southland's biggest stories. Hold on tight, this bundle of joy weighs in at 14 pounds. And will the Mighty Ducks tie with the Kings in the Pacific Division? The Channel 5 News at 10. Tonight,
buying a Toyota truck, there's one important option you should know about. The Ford Ranger.
And what an option. You can lease a 94 Ranger XLT for just $192 a month for 2 years. After rebate, all you need is just $392 in cash. And look what $392 gets you. Rear anti-lock brakes, power steering, sliding rear window, AM-FM stereo cassette, alloy wheels. Hey, only one compact truck is built Ford tough. The Ranger.
The Broadway 2-Day Sale has colorful holiday savings everywhere you look. Start with warm gift ideas that accent the season with bold knits and pure cotton comfort. Add fun to your weekend in quilted silk and playful hats. Pick out classic gifts for office hours and more casual times. Make holiday shopping a lot more fun with 2 days of savings. Save on the perfect compliments for any holiday gathering. Or make sure your best holiday memories will last a lifetime. The 2-day sale Friday and Saturday, 8 to 11 at the Broadway.
From the House of Stetson. Preferred Doc Cologne. What preferred men prefer.
If you have problems falling asleep, now your world is about to change. Introducing Unisom Sleep Gels with a special liquid center. They're maximum strength, so they're as effective as anything you can get without a prescription. They help you fall asleep fast and wake up refreshed. If you have problems falling asleep, try new maximum strength Unisom Sleep Gels. A remarkable new idea from Unisom.
201 birthdays. 67 holidays. 16 anniversaries. 1 Mixmaster Mixer. Sunbeam. The power that lasts for generations. Sunbeam. Made for life.
How did Carl's Jr. catch the unique flavor of Baja in a deliciously different new burger? Start with Carl's spicy Santa Fe sauce. Tangy onions. A big charbroiled beef patty. Cheese. Sizzling bacon. All topped with zesty guacamole. The new Baja Guacamole Burger. Now just $1.59. $1.59. Only at Carl's Jr. It's spicy, but not pricey. Carl's Jr., where the food is the star.
This holiday season, give him a gift that will help bring you a little closer. The revolutionary Gillette Sensor.
The Ross store-wide clearance. Prices have been reduced dramatically throughout the store. Great savings for men, women, and kids. The Ross store-wide clearance. Now.
Super Lotto. Who's next?
Our friends, Roger and Laura, they own the store where we bought the ticket. We gave them a pool.
Super Lotto. Who's next?
The 1960s began on a high note as John F. Kennedy is elected president. It would turn out to be a decade of turmoil and tragedy. And in the tranquil hills of Bel Air, catastrophe would be played out in November 1961, the Bel Air fire.
I had taken the day off. Bev and I were able to, we got babysitters for all the children. We went down to Malibu. We were down there, one of the Malibu hotels, having our vacation for the year probably. And we woke up in the morning and saw this huge black cloud covering the whole eastern sky. We just couldn't believe it. We looked at each other, and I said, well, I'm sure it's nothing. And so it took us 5 minutes before I called in. and then again to go there. And for me, for the first time, to see this widespread devastation and to see homes, so many of them, just gone. And I remember that wonderful phrase when we were saying, these are $100,000 homes that have been destroyed. And then to hear that there are various movie stars and other well-known people who'd lost their homes. And for this to continue for, you know, a couple of days, and then to go back at the end and see nothing but row after row of burned out skeletons, burned out homes, was another thing that just made a tremendous impression on me.
And, you know, another Borate bomber coming in right now, coming in very low, right at the front of the fire, drops its load, and we all pray that it hits. Stretch Adler's been on the fire line since about 9 o'clock this morning. Stretch, how does the fire look now compared to when you got here early this morning?
Well, Stan, it's pretty hard to evaluate. It's so vast. As you can see in front of us, we've got many hot spots and far, I guess it's to the north of us. Looks like another big holocaust is letting loose. I hear over in Topanga Canyon they're having a considerable amount of trouble. I hear there are about 1,500 acres that are on fire. Of course, this is all hearsay. I have no way of really knowing.
Our camera moving down at 8:10 this morning. Five homes right in a row down. And then, as fate would have it, two that are not burned. We just had a report that spot fires have broken out in the Presbyterian Conference grounds at 15601 Sunset Boulevard in Pacific Palisades.
1962. KTLA starts the first ever local morning news program. It's called AMLA, and of course, Stan Chambers is chosen to head up the show. In 1964, another first, a local news show which is broadcast from an actual newsroom.
Live, Golden West Broadcasters present the sights and sounds of the Southland. Transmitting with live television units, the exclusive helicopter and telemobile. KTLA camera crews rush to you each night the news of this day on News Picture 530. Now from KTLA News Control, here is Stan Chambers.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to News Control. First, this late report. The Federal Space Agency says that hurricanes have damaged at Cape Kennedy and forced the cancellation of the two-man Gemini space flight this year. The flight has been reset for early next year. As you can see, we're here in our new News Control. Our broadcast moving to 5:30 now. The reason we've moved here is in order that we can bring to you late developments as they take place. Tonight, KTLA inaugurates a new concept in sports coverage. The players themselves, the professionals who play the games, will be here at our sports desk. Tonight, we welcome a wonderful fellow, a great pitcher, Don Drysdale. Nice to have you, Don.
Thank you, Stan. Nice to be aboard. Well, the Fighting Phils of Philadelphia are still six games in front of the National League, and it looks like this is going to be the year for the Phillies.
That's the latest of this hour. Be sure to join us in News Control tonight at 10:30.
In August of 1965, the community of Watts exploded in 6 days of violence. 34 people died, and more than $40 million worth of property was destroyed.
We want to talk to cameraman Ed Clark, who just returned from the area. Ed, you just got here moments ago. You were there all night long. Could you tell us how it was tonight compared to last night?
Well, Sam, in my 15 years in news business, this is undoubtedly the worst thing I think I've ever seen involving violence. This is the worst I've ever seen.
But this fire here at Martin's is completely out of control. Fire equipment in attendance. The one a block away at Carl's Shoe Store, out of control. No fire equipment at the scene. The National Guard has been called, and I never was sure in my mind how many were actually there on the line. But it was my understanding that the National Guard was there, and then the tremendous uproar, the literally hundreds of buildings that were burned and the rioting so great, you wonder just what steps had to be taken if this situation was to be controlled.
By the mid-60s, L.A.'s Chamber of Commerce declares that Los Angeles has now passed Chicago to become the second largest city in the United States. And the Dorothy Chandler Pavilion at the Music Center is dedicated. Well, there is other news, and Stan is there to report it. 1966 was a busy year for KTLA's television station on wheels, the Telemobile, able to transmit live picture and sound from anywhere in the Southland to viewers at home. The Telemobile was on hand for a variety of dramatic stories. Perhaps the most exciting of these was the mid-November crash of the Goodyear blimp. Videotape Enterprises cameramen, recording a commercial nearby, trained their cameras on the impending crash, just in time to record these scenes. Moments later, the Channel 5 Telemobile was rolling. As we arrived, the 160-foot blimp was draped over power lines. Although no one was injured, damage to the bag was extensive. Repair work took nearly 8 weeks before the blimp was airborne again. Then less than a week before the blimp crash, violent weather was making its toll in the Southland, and for the first time in several years, a tornado struck with enough force to do major damage. The Ramona Elementary School was among the structures damaged, and the KTLA Telecopter and Telemobile again brought viewers the live drama. The KTLA Telemobile has now moved to the Ramona School, which is about 135th Street in Ramona. That's a good 20 blocks from our last transmission over on Turo Street at 119th. And here you see some of the damage done to the school. Fortunately, there was little structural damage, but trees were blown down here on the school grounds. There was considerable damage to windows, trees, tar papering of the roof. And right now from the Hawthorne Public and Works Public Works Department, the men are repairing the tar paper on the roof. A roaring fire in Maywood, California, here on Atlantic Boulevard near 61st Street. A food giant market is completely engulfed in flames. A shoe store next to it has been completely gutted. And there a big section falls down. A huge section of the market just crashes to the street below. The flames are 50 feet into the air. One of the major local stories of 1967 involved the visit to Los Angeles by President Johnson on June 23rd. Flying to the City of the Angels at the conclusion of the Glassboro, New Jersey Summit Conference with Soviet Premier Kosygin, the chief executive arrived by helicopter at the Century Plaza Hotel. Awaiting his arrival was thousands of anti-Vietnam War protesters who filled the Avenue of the Stars with placards and later clashed violently with police. The holiday season of 1967 was given an additional boost of gaiety with the long-awaited arrival at Long Beach of Britain's pride of the seas, the Queen Mary. The 81,000-ton vessel had been purchased by the city of Long Beach for $3,444,000. It will be converted to a museum, hotel, convention, and shopping complex. The huge vessel on its way to Pier E following the lengthy trip around Cape Horn. Her arrival in the Southland is a fitting conclusion to 1967 and a promise to start 1968 as she prepares to serve as a Marine exhibit of worldwide fame.
KTLA salute to Stan Chambers' return with a look at the 1970s and Stan's most unusual assignment.
I'm Hal Fishman. Coming up tonight on News at 10, a late-breaking story about the crash of a commuter airplane. A prime suspect arrested in the kidnapping of a 12-year-old girl. And another chamber in the Stan Chambers story, this time a story that terrified the Southland just a few weeks ago. We'll have all the latest news tonight on News at 10.
The doors are open in 93 to the best of 94. It's Toyota's first sales event of the new model year. There's Silver Anniversary option package savings on Corolla. And a Toyota Touch lease that makes it easy to get into Corolla. A benchmark of quality in America for 25 years. Take advantage of our one-price two- or four-door Tercel ZX with option package savings. Either one, one price. The best of 94 sales event makes November the best time to buy.
All right, that package you sent to Denver, it never got there.
What?
Introducing tracking software from Federal Express.
It was picked up at 5:20 last night, and it was delivered at 9:42 a.m. and signed for by Kate Donovan. Shall I call it for you, sir?
Never mind.
Now you can track packages right from your computer on your desk.
Sylmar? The Czech party mix is for the guests? Good grief.
Don't worry. Now it's so easy. You can make more in 10 minutes.
I can't even make toast.
Just mix up the Czechs and the seasonings, take it in a bag, and pop it in the microwave.